Welcome to Time Travel 27, and a look at the photo and cine film collection of pioneer British hot rodder Ken Flathead Cooper from 1959 to 1969. Having always been into American cars, especially those made by Henry, Ken decided that his first car would have to be a Ford V8, and after 2 years searching, came across this 37 Ford Coupe, which he bought for £50 in 1959. Ken ran the car in stock condition for a while before giving it a California rake by reversing the front spring eyes and raising the back with a block above the rear spring. He also fitted 750 tyres on the back and 520s on the front. In 1962, Ken joined the Ford V8 Register. The bulletin editor was Pete Farnell, and he owned this 36 coupe fitted with a 52 truck engine and hydraulic brakes. Taller tyres on the rear gave it the required rake, and the rear bumper was off a 39 Packard, which Pete thought looked better than the old V-shaped Ford item. Also in 1962, Ken Cooper formed a club called the Roadrunners to try and bring together hot rodders in the Birmingham area. Another club at the time was the Sprinters, run by Vic Outon and Mike Titterton. Ken also joined the National Hot Rod Association to receive National Dragster and keep up with what was going on at the drags in America at the time. And he was member number 86 of the British Hot Rod Association, which had come into existence in 1960 due to the efforts of Brian Coole. By now, Ken's 37 coupe had received some attention in the go department. The 21 stud flathead was replaced by a 24 stud 41 Mercury mill, fitted with dual exhaust and motorcycle mufflers. The coupe was resprayed yellow and taken along to the British Hot Rod Association's first get-together in August 1962 at the Watling Street Garage, just off Junction 9 of the M1. Easter 1963 saw the UK's first Rod and Custom Show organised by the British Hot Rod Association. After a search for a suitable venue, John Bennett offered the use of his Spa Engineering workshops. Adverts went into Motoring News and the Evening News, as well as local shop windows, and a good crowd turned up to look at the rods and customs. Ken Cooper had his yellow coupe there, and this is Alan Doyle's 32 coupe, which had the four banger replaced by a Pilot V8. Hydraulic brakes and telescopic shocks were also fitted, along with Mercury wheels on the front and wide section Jeep wheels out back. Alan Herridge turned up with a DD Buick dragster behind his Model B limousine. The dragster had just run a 1668 first time out at Debden. Engine was a 39 Buick straight 8 with Buick gearbox and rear axle. Front axle was Model B Ford. Brian Coole entered his 34 Ford sedan, which was lowered all round and fitted with hydraulics. An English V8 sat in the engine bay, complete with high compression alley finned heads and two jug manifold sporting Solex carbs. It was painted midnight blue with purple tint, many components were chromed, and the wheels were fitted with spider bullets. Representing the custom side of the show was Dave Moss's 53 console, fitted with French quad headlamps, a 56 Zephyr bumper and front and rear rolled pans. Inside, the dash was chromed and the door panels covered in leather. Tail fins had been fabricated from Bonder glass and Anglia tail lights fitted. An extended Continental spare wheel kit sat above a 61 Zodiac rear bumper. Also at the show was a Scalectrics track to keep the kids happy and a large display of members' models. Everyone who had a cart entered at the show received one of these trophies. After the show, Ken wrote a letter to Don Garlitz, telling him what was happening in Britain at the time. A few weeks later, he received a reply, along with details of the dragster chassis Don was building and a bunch of photos of the Swamp Rat in action. Ken Cooper had begun construction of a dragster chassis himself, around the same time that Alan Herridge had started building his Buick dragster. But when he found out that the RAC did not have a class for dragsters, meaning running the car in racing car class with front brakes and an engine cover, he gave up on the idea and left the dragster chassis at the bottom of his garden and decided instead to build another hot rod. This time, after another search, Ken found a 33 Ford Cabriolet and paid £35 for it. The previous owner had allowed the original engine to freeze up and had replaced it with a Model B 4-banger and commercial gearbox. Ken kept this setup for a while before replacing it with a 48 Mercury V8 mated to a 33 transmission. Ken believed that a classic hot rod should have a 32 grille shell and had to buy this complete 32 sedan to get one. Before fitting the V8, Ken stripped it down, relieved the block and enlarged the inlet ports, hard graft but necessary to make a flathead breathe. Stellite tipped valves and Lincoln Zephyr springs were installed with a 3/4 race cam and Johnson tappets. The displacement was increased by fitting a 4-inch stroke 53 Mercury crankshaft and a 49 Mercury oil pump increased the oil pressure to 80 pounds. The flathead was topped off with two Stromberg 97s. Ken reversed the eyes and took three leaves out the front spring and fitted jack tube shocks. 36 steel wheels and 39 hydraulic brakes were fitted, actuated by a 62 Zodiac pedaler master cylinder. And to keep it legal, Ken added motorcycle fenders. September 1963 saw two American dragsters come to England for a series of demonstrations organised by Sidney Allard. Ken took these pictures of Mickey Thompson's Harvey Aluminium Special at Church Lawford. Also present was the immaculate Moon Eyes dragster being driven by Dante Deuce. Ken managed to take this close-up shot of Mickey Thompson as he talked to the crowd. The Harvey Aluminium machine was powered by a fuel-burning 427 Ford. Mickey got it down to an 884-178 the following day at Debden, but the Church Lawford strip was too bumpy for full-power runs. If you've seen Time Travel 15, you'll know that the young man standing in front of Moon Eyes with a cine camera is Roy Phelps. The Moon Eyes dragster used a petrol-burning Chevy and had run a 948-166 at Silverstone a week earlier, but was also having trouble hooking up to the strip at Church Lawford. The 1964 Birmingham Motorist Fair saw a British Hot Rod Association stand containing Alan Herridge's DD Buick dragster and Ken Cooper's 33 Cabriolet. Bootsy's Buick now had a blower fitted and lightened front end. These colour shots of Ken's hot rod show the gleaming Henry Ford black paint job and red chassis. American dragsters again came to England in 1964 when Sidney Allard and the newly formed British Drag Racing Association organised the first international drag festivals. That's Dave Strickler's factory experimental Dodge. George Montgomery comes off the line in his Chevy Willis. Dante Deuce was back over, driving the Moon Eyes sports car. Another Willis guesser was the Hemi-powered machine of K.S. Pittman. Bob Keith gets fired up in the Dos Palmas Chevy Rail. And that's the Porsche-powered dragster of Californian Doug Church. Tony Nancy had brought over his radical wedge dragster. By 1964, more British dragsters were beginning to appear. That's Tony Densham's Warden in the near lane against Dennis Jenkinson in an LR Dragon, both machines using blown 1500 Fords. The original Jag-powered Hound Dog takes on Bootsy's DD Buick, which wins despite blowing at the top end. Here, Alan Allard in the Works Dragon takes on Doug Church. Ronnie Sox was there in his Mercury Comet. Alan Allard in the Allard Chrysler takes on Dante Deuce. Watch the top end charge of Nancy's machine as he takes on Bob Keith. The cars everybody came to see were the fuel dragsters of Don Garlitz and Tommy Ivo, who ran a series of 8-second, 190-mile-an-hour match races during the series. Whitsun 1965 saw the running of the British Hot Rod Association's second big go at Duxford. In the near lane is the Cooper Norton ex-Formula 3 car of A. Parker, which came up against Jeff Theobald's Jag Slingshot during practice. This was Jeff's second dragster to date and was running low 14s with speeds just nudging the ton. Here A. Parker comes out again against the Cadillac-powered T-Bucket of Richard Wright, which was running high 14s. In the near lane is Derek Metcalf in his TR2-powered dragster and alongside John Hume driving the Works Allard Dragon, which recorded an incredible 11 flat at 126 miles an hour during practice. Derek Metcalf was the only car entered in B Dragster, so won his Eliminator with a solo run in 18.65 seconds at 69 miles an hour. In the D Dragster class, Les Hill, driving Nobby Hill's new Hound Dog 2, had a bye run into the final. The other semi saw Richard Wright shut down Jeff Theobald, who suffered a misfire. Les Hill took the final with an excellent 12.32, 113 miles an hour. The Wright brothers' 5.4 Cadillac-powered T used an old auto box and rear axle. Wheels were Buick, and the chassis was half Allard and half homemade. The Model T body had been built from a Morris 8 roof section. This is Jeff Jago's radically customised Fordston van, which Jeff entered in the British Hot Rod Association's second Rod and Custom show at Hyde Park Underground Car Park and won the best of show. By 1965, Ken Cooper decided it was about time to drag his dragster chassis literally out of the weeds at the bottom of his garden and resume construction again. The RAC now recognised dragsters as a separate class, and front brakes and engine covers were no longer required. Once again, a flathead V8 was chosen to power the car. It was a 48 Mercury, the same as what went into the 33 Cabriolet. In fact, Ken was lucky enough to buy both motors brand new at the same time for £40 each. Once again, the block was relieved and the ports enlarged and polished. Another 53 crank went in, and an Iski cam was purchased from Shells in California for £7. Ken paid £17.10 for 3 hollies and a Navro manifold. These were mainly fed straight alcohol, although Ken would occasionally try other additives which took his fancy. A wheelcap flywheel and racing clutch mated to a 39 Mercury gearbox with first and reverse gears removed. Rear axle was a 40 Ford item, fitted with 3 54 gears, later swapped for 4 11s. Front axle was a 39 Mercury unit, which Ken had lightened and fitted with 34 spindles and motorcycle wheels. The radius rods were Ford Pilot steering columns, and the exhaust headers were made from the outer casings of the same columns. Wheelbase was 108 inches, and the bodywork was made from aluminium sheet. The steering wheel was a cut-down Austin A30 item, and the fuel tank was a Ford windscreen wiper vacuum tank. Ken came along to the 1999 Nostalgia Nationals at Avon Park, and he spotted his Navro manifold at the swap meet there. Ken took the car along to Gravely in 1965. He'd named it the Roadrunner, but when a 59 Chevy turned up with the same name, he changed the name to Bazooka. This meet saw 8 British slingshots turn up, and here they were all getting in line for a photo shoot which appeared in the October 65 issue of British Drag Racing magazine. From left to right, they're Nobby Hill's Hound Dog 2, Alan Herridge's Cadillac Pulsation, Ken Cooper's Roadrunner, Derek Metcalf's TR2 Dragster, Leon Moss's Square One, Les Turner's Ford Dragster, Colin Glass's Bristol Dragon, and Harold Ball's Strip Duster. Also at Gravely that day was a genuine American hot rod, which had been imported in 1962 and was owned by Hugh Langrish Smith. The channeled Model A had a 283 VET motor, topped off with 6 hollies on an offy manifold. Second time out at Gravely, and Ken had narrowed the rear end and fitted Allard brakes and Bentley wheels with 7 25x15 Dunlop racing tyres, which originally came from Toby Griffiths Hillclimb BRM. Ken had splashed out £34 for a pair of Edelbrook heads, given a compression ratio of 11 to 1. These shots were taken in 1966 at the newly opened Santa Pod Raceway, as Ken takes on Alan Herridge in his Cadillac Rail Pulsation. In 1966 saw the first American Commandos visit to Santa Fog, including E.J. Potter, who smoked his injected 327 Chevy-powered bike to 10-second ETs at 140 miles an hour. Bud Barnes brought over the ultrasonic Top Fuel Dragster and set a new strip record at 8.57. Gilbert Mudrat was there in the Runt, a 23 T-bodied fueler, and he ran a best of 9.03. Larry Arnold clocked a 10.82 in the Lawman Anglia, fitted with a Hillborn injected 327. Team captain was Al Ekstrand, driving his 86 Dodge Charger. He ran several match races with British drivers, including Gerald Tyack, who beat him with a best of three in his incredibly quick Cobra. This is Derek Metcalf's TR2 dragster, now called Wombat, and fitted here with a shortened Jag overhead valve cylinder head. This is the 500cc four-valve Rudge-powered machine of Tony Gain, called Wicked Lady, which had the last laugh on everyone when it won the 1966 British Drag Racing Championships. The unladen weight of the machine was a mere 250 pounds, and the front end could be lifted with one finger. The go-kart-type front wheels were later swapped for Morton bicycle wheels and tyres, which raised the front end and gave Tony better vision, but he must have been a bit worried, crossing the finish line at 100 miles an hour, held up by wheels designed for a push bike. Jerry Boughton's Allard Dragon, which had been driven by Dennis Jenkinson at the drag festivals, was now run by Pete Atkins, who ran Watford Motor Accessories, and he had renamed the car Dragonfly. In 69, Pete sold the car to Doug Harler, who then sold it to John Rotherham, and it's now being raced by Alan Smith with the Wild Bunch. Here's a driver's eye view of the cockpit. Sadly, the neat Dragstar Go pedal is no longer on the car. Harold Ball was getting quicker and quicker in his 998 BMC strip duster. Later in the year, he lengthened the frame and fitted homemade fuel injection and a splash of nitro. This is Clive Lingard's 317 Lincoln-powered dragster called Purple Heart. Like Ken Cooper, Clive was one of Britain's pioneer hot rodders, having built a Model Y hot rod in the early 60s, and also, at the same time, formed the Dragons Hot Rod Club in Manchester. The winter of 66 and 67 saw Ken Cooper build a second dragster called Bazooka 2. The engine, trans, rear axle and wheels were all from the old car. The new tube frame measured 122 inches and Alan Herridge made up a torsion bar setup onto which Ken hung his much lightened Ford beam axle. Total weight of the car was less than £1,000. Tony Beadle, Don Beadle and Alan Herridge ran Speed and Custom Parts, where Ken would get a lot of his speed parts. This action was filmed at the first practice meet of 67 at Santa Pod. That's Alan Ing's Turner Climax and Dee Jessen's Elan against the Lotus 7 of Ken Obi. B Brown in the Daimler Dart takes on Raymond Elliott's Red Witch XK150. And that's the Ferrari of A. LaFault, which established a new 3000cc class record of 13.23 seconds, 107 miles an hour. B Cunningham takes on the XK120 Jag of Dave Cottingham. That's Clive Lingard in his modified production Zodiac, then two F-modified 1500 Cortinas of W. Whittaker and S. Rapson. Programs and race reports in the 60s rarely printed full Christian names, so unless I know otherwise, it's just initials. There's no mistaking these guys, Dave Ryswick in his 57 Chevy and Don Davis in his GTO. Ryswick got the gate job of the year as Davis slept on the line. This is the Parlett chassis altered of Robin Bulch, fitted with Allard heads, twin carbs and copper exhausts. Body was homemade in aluminium. In the far lane, the new stagecoach Jag Austin Ruby of Pete Myria. In the near lane, a young Dennis Priddle in Wicked Lady takes on Harold Ball. Jack Fisher lights up the front tyres in his mini base machine Sodbuster. And that's Brian Rigsall winning forward the Jag-powered Wee Green P. Mark Stratton in the new Hustler Chevy BSA takes on the Jag Model Y juggernaut of Bob Eyre. Stagecoach comes out again to take on yet another new machine for 67, Keith Sow's Megalomania. Powered by a 396 Chevy, the MGB base machine had numerous body modifications carried out by fiberglass repairs. Dee Jessen brings out his Elan again against Alan Ing's Turner Climax, which he later swapped for Chris Patterson's Works Allard Dragon. That's Ian Domain in his Mustang-powered Zodiac. Martin Brooks was running the ex-Bellamy circuit racing pot with 1500 Cortina power. And now a look at the first motorcycle drag championships at Santa Pod. That's Stuart Bromley on his 125 Lambretta, and in the other lane, a mean-looking Norman Hyde on his 350 Triumph Roadrunner 2. And that's John Lloyd on his 1949 998 Vincent. Stu Bradbury sprints to the line as Ian Richardson brings out his 2000cc flat 4 Formula 1 racing car engine monster called Moonraker. That's M Biggs on Longshot and M Cook on his 650 BSA. S- star of the show was this man, Alf Hagen, who a few weeks previous had made history on his mighty jet machine by becoming the first bike rider into the nines with a 993 at Duxford. Everyone was eager to see him run a nine at Santa Pod, and National Dragways announced they would give out £10 for each 9-second run recorded at the meet. Ever ingenious Alf had come up with a system to keep the clutch cool. It was a jack trolley which kept the rear wheel clear off the deck once the big twin was started to allow the clutch to stay home whilst he was wheeled up to the line. Then it was out clutch, lower bike, line up and blast off. This run produced a 9.93, equaling the Duxford run, and John Bennett presented Alf with £10 as he returned to the pits. Later in the day, Alf faced Pete Allen in the top eliminator final and won with an incredible 9.67 at 143 miles an hour. That's Norman Hyde again, complete with flame-painted helmet. And that's John Lloyd coming out for a smoky matchup with Ian Richardson. A private meeting was arranged for August the 8th at Santa Pod, as Anglia Television wanted to record some of the action for a short film to publicise the bank holiday meeting. The Hustler team turned up and the camera crew were queuing for rides in the BSA. Ken Cooper was there and put down a few 12-second runs for the cameras. Alan Blount had his injected Chevy Weekend Warrior there, but ended the day with a burnt-out clutch. This was the last appearance for Weekend Warrior until 68. When the team debuted a brand new Weekend Warrior 2. This is the Black Horse Racing Team's foam-blown T-Bird engine dragster called Banshee, which also suffered a burnt out clutch, and due to losing a bit of the plumbing, the oil was boiled in the sump. On now to 1968. And a look at the new Mark Stratton machine, a twin Chevy slingshot piloted by Colin Saunders. 1968 saw hound dogs start to fly as Nobby Hill sorted out the fuel injection problems in the Cadillac-powered Hound Dog 3, and moving Mike Hutchison took several top eliminator wins. Clive Skelton was running the Allard Chrysler Rail, which hadn't been seen since 65. That's the Mustang of Gary Goggin. As Joe Rico's Mustang drives by, following Gary Goggin's red Mustang, the guy standing the other side of the Jag with a cine camera is probably Ron Fisher, recording the action used in Time Travel 2. And that's Good Vibrations, the Marshall Dixon Olds Anglia. Geronimo made its first appearance in 68, and next door, Chris Leaney's Comma Dragster is wheeled out. Walt Ithell turned up with his 671 GMC blown 283 Chevy powered slingshot called the Poltergeist. That's John Harrison's Austin Healey powered Jinx. Hi Harold. Hi Derek. That's Harold Ball in the blue sweater and Derek Metcalf with the hat on, who joined forces to become B&M Equipment. And here's a look at the incredibly quick strip duster, now blown and injected. Resident Sandapod RAC scrutineer was Captain Tom Howes. Alan Herridge, Alan Ing, and Derek Metcalf do a bit of bench racing. Nobby Hills checks out Hound Dog in his trouser turn-ups. Joe Kopp blasts by in his 57 as Chris Leaney gets ready for a run. Geronimo was driven by Mick Tickner in 68, powered by a 49 Olds rocket, bored out to 324 cubic inches, running alcohol through Hillborn fuel injection. Good Vibrations blast by, then Joe Kopp takes on Rico. John Harrison gets ready for a run in the immaculately turned out gold metal flaked Jinx, which was a very apt name, as John spent most of 68 sorting out problems with the car. Tick Tickner puts in another run in Geronimo, before Ken Cooper heads for home in his Mark 1 console. Bazooka 2 had a few subtle mods for 68, such as triple Strombergs replacing the Hollies and new metal sprayed headers at the other end of the gasworks. The rear axle now had 3.5 gears, replacing the 4.11s. Moving Mike Hutchison in Hound Dog shuts down Alan Ng in the Works Dragon. Alan Ng and Moving Mike come back down after their run as we move on to the 68 August Championships, which started out wet on the Sunday as a brave Rex Sluggett puts in two twitchy 12 second runs in the Keith Black Fuller Tudor Rose. Mark Stratton now had 4.27 power in Hustler, but here gets beat by Hugh Gunderson's Oscar II Cortina, which had a handicap start. Pete Atkins, Slow Motion, takes on John Cassell's Anticlimax. Then it's Colin Mullen's Invader against Tony Brown's Limelight. Tony Densham chewed Commuter to an out-of-shape 11.96 on a damp track. Good Vibration shuts down Invader, which blew the Hemi, and Harold Ball blows away the new car of Phil Elson. Megalomania takes on the Church Brothers' Gold Rush Pop. Rex Sluggett ran a warm-up 10-second run before the first AA Fueler matchup on the Monday, which saw Tony Densham win with an 8.52 to Sluggett's Red Light 8.69. Second matchup, and Dennis Priddle was in the hot seat of Tudor Rose. This time it's a double greenie, with Dennis winning with a hole shot 8.88 to Commuter's quicker 8.83. Tick Tickner got Geronimo down to a 10-1 on his way to the championship final, where he'd meet Alan Herridge in Motivation, who was having engine problems and here records 12.37. Before the championship final, Tudor Rose and Commuter come down for their third matchup. Dennis ran top times of the day, an 8.46 at 171 miles an hour, as Tony slowed to a 9.05. The championship final saw Herridge win and also become the first junior fueler outside the States into the nines with a 9.90 at 141 to Geronimo's 10.07, 144, and then the rains came down. That's George Gillette's Jack Austin, George's Dragon, which later became known as Wild Honey. And that's Pete Atkins' LR Dragon. And just behind Hustler, Jerry Cookson's Troubleshooter. That's Weekend Warrior 2 and Les Field's Chevy Bike, inspired by EJ Potter. Also inspired by EJ was Steve Perry, who put a Ford V6 in his bike, but it didn't have quite enough power to keep the slick ball in for the full quarter. We're now in 1969, which saw the start of combined car and bike meetings. That's DJ Lowe's 350 AJS. And Dave Klee's blown 650 Triumph shotgun. Number 222 was the nitro burning blown 500 Triumph Endeavour of Bernie White. Back to cars as Russell Ward in his Jag Pop takes on the V6 Cortina of Hugh Gunderson in Street Altered. A. LaFault Jr. was running a Ferrari in Middle Street, clocking mid-15s, while A. LaFault Sr. was running his 65 3-litre Ferrari in Top Street, clocking high 12s. Phil Ziggy Smith brings out his Daimler Opus Street Altered called Anomalous 2. That's Derek Benbow's Turtle T taking on Dave Collis in Opus 1. Dennis Priddle comes down the far up road in the Wild 427 Whistler Reliant to take on Bill McGrath's Triumph Roadster called Gloink. Burt Knight in Nightmare 2 takes on Mick Wheeler's Scorpion. Alan Blount comes down the far up road to race Ken Cooper, who by now had really got his flathead flying, then into the 10 second bracket. He later recorded a 10.68 at 132, which still stands today as the quickest and fastest flathead time in Britain. Geronimo was now piloted by John Siggery, who was a bit taller than Mick Tickner and his head stuck above the roll bar. Roy Phelps brings out the wheelie Stingray before Steve Perry has another go on his V6 bike. Alf Hagen was looking cool in his new white leathers. He now had the record down to a 9.43.153. Commuter was the only AA fueler running in 69 and never quite managed a hoped for 7 second run. That's Rob Skinner in the Jag powered Midas Touch. That's Ian Garbutt's Ford powered Topolino High Fever and Tony Anderson's V6 Trouble. Dennis Priddle drops the laundry in Whistler and Ziggy Smith loads up his clockwork Opus.